Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this closing session of our meeting today on Syria and its neighbours. I'm Robin Niblett, Director of Chatham House, and I'm sorry to only be joining you now from what I hear has been a very good conversation over the previous two sessions. But we thought it would be especially good to have this opportunity now to reflect on some of the main challenges that we will be addressing over the course of this project in the coming years, but also reflect a bit on the specificities of the challenges of the moment in Syria and its immediate neighborhood with Lakhdar Brahimi. I think he is well known to everyone here. He's been sitting, listening, I said to him in a minute ago, assiduously to the conversation without, as I understand it, jumping in with his contributions. So I'm sure he's stored up a number of his key thoughts and ideas, which he will share with us now. And as I think, as everyone knows, he has served as the UN and Arab League Special Envoy to Syria right through 2 years to May 2014. But he brought with him an extensive experience as a UN Special Envoy, having served in a similar role in Afghanistan, in Iraq, South Africa, back in 93 to 94, and obviously brought his own governmental experience as having served as Foreign Minister of Algeria from 91 to 93, and is now, and has been for a while, a member of the Elders Group. In fact, Mr. Brahimi, we've had the pleasure of welcoming you here before in that capacity. And I'm delighted that joining us here for the final session here as well is my colleague at Chatham House, Michael Williams, Lord Williams of Baglan. And Michael, who brings his own knowledge, extensive knowledge of the region, not least as former Undersecretary General of the UN for the Middle East up until 2011, but somebody with also long-standing experience, including in the UK government of this part of the world. And Michael will have a few questions, I think, as well for Lakhdar, maybe after I kick off with a few myself. So we're going to run this through not much beyond 5:15, so it's just me a short conversation to try to pick out some key ideas here and see where we go from here. And I was advised both by Neil Quilliam and also by Michael Williams to try to take advantage, Mr. Brahimi, of your presence here, to get into the nuggets and the detail of what we might do next. In this part of the region. Maybe you're freed up a little bit at the moment to be able to answer that kind of question in a way that you might not have been able to do when you had your formal role. Because I think it's an opportunity for us to understand where we're kicking this project off, that Michael is executive chairing as well for us at Chatham House, that you can give us some of your thoughts. And maybe the most obvious one to start with is with the role that President Assad may or may not play in the future. I think you had been quite clear during your time as the special envoy that in a way he would need to step aside and that he would have to be kingmaker rather than president, I think was a phrase he used at some point. Do you think that context has now fundamentally changed, that in some way or another, with the way the conflict has evolved, with the rise of ISIS, that in essence President Assad now represents one of the players of a multifaceted solution, and therefore he will have to lead part of the solution rather than be somebody who leads by stepping aside? Has the situation changed there, do you think?
No, it hasn't. Thank you very much for inviting me. It's an honor and a pleasure to come back to Chatham House. You know, President Assad and the people around him have never doubted that they are going to win. And therefore, you know, they never took seriously, except for a very short period of time, the idea of negotiations with anybody. They were certain that they were going to win, and I'm absolutely certain that they didn't believe that. but they kept to that narrative, that this is an alien intervention in our affairs, mostly by foreigners, who were sent by the Americans, the Israelis, and I don't know who else. Yeah. So they have never changed from that position, except perhaps at the around the end of 2012, where things looked a little bit bad for them, and they may have hesitated for a little while. But for them, this is this is an aggression from outside, and we are capable of defeating it, and we shall do so. They started by saying it will take a few days, a few weeks. I think the Russians say that they discussed with them some stage, and they told them, just give us 3 weeks, and it will all be over. I think they then realized that it was a little bit longer than that, but they have never changed from that position.
And if they haven't changed their position, but do you think their ultimate aim then is to try somehow to reconquer
absolutely
all of Syria? That remains the aim. Sitting in a rump state down the Mediterranean border is not.
The other thing, at that question of being the kingmaker, this is something I think it has been leaked. This is what I told President Bashar. I said, you and your father have governed Syria for 42 years. It's enough. you can be the kingmaker now. One day, things have to change. I doubt whether your son will succeed you. So why not start now thinking of... first time, he was polite. Second time, he said, I'm a Syrian citizen. You all speak about democracy and elections. If there is an election and I feel like standing, why shouldn't I? If I get 50% plus one vote, I stay. If I get 50% less one vote, I will leave. So this was his attitude.
And so if I look ahead now, we look ahead to the next 6 months or so. Do you see them playing a role? Their role is to try to achieve complete victory, or their role is to find the best position from which to negotiate something short of it?
To negotiate, co-opting a few nice people who were not part of the regime now into the present regime.
Right.
No change.
And just one more point on this kind of context. I know that there's been some discussion in the first session about whether, given the failures of some of the top-down approach to resolving the conflict, Geneva in particular, the Geneva process, whether we're going to move to a phase of bottom-up, local truces, small ceasefires in regions. I would imagine that's a space in which the Assad regime would see itself playing a negotiating role. So
very much so.
Is that the way you see potentially the conflict, if it can be resolved, moving towards resolution as pressure is put on ISIS?
I hate to contradict Reem Turkmani, but I'm afraid, look, what you have now is only war plans. There is no peace plan. I mean, Reem has a peace plan. But the people who are actually, taking the decisions on all sides, they have only war plans. That negotiation in Homs was a very interesting negotiation. I think it was in March or April. Very, very interesting negotiation. But it was part of the government's war plan. They have kept they have destroyed most of the city and kept it under siege for 2 years. And then they said, now we are willing to listen to you and let you come out. If it were part of the, if you can have the search negotiations as part of a peace plan, that would be a different, that would be a different story. The other thing is, you have the people in the region and elsewhere do not have peace plans. Only we at the UN had, you know, shy peace plans that nobody was interested in. The Russians and the Iranians are supporting the regime to win the war, and everybody else is trying to support oppositions to win the war against Russia. This is what you have. The day we start talking about peace, you know, things will be different.
Well, just quickly on the external players, again, you've commented in the past on how important the Saudi-Iranian relationship obviously is in this context. I would have thought in the time when you were serving as special envoy, that was one of the core problems with any type of solution, was the proxy nature of the conflict in Syria for both Saudi Arabia and Iran. Now, with the rise of ISIL, Daesh, what does this, has the context changed, in your opinion, for the outlook of the leaderships in those two countries sufficiently for them to perhaps bring a different perspective to the conflict in Syria?
Yes, I think that the context has changed tremendously. Look, a conflict like the one you have in Syria, by nature, if it goes on, will spill over. This is a law. If you have a conflict like this, it's called an internal conflict. But ultimately, it will spill over. It is also, it spills over at some stage, but then it attracts also a lot of attention and a lot of intervention into it. This is a law. Look at any conflict, you will find that a lot of foreigners are interfering, and the conflict spills over, starting with the refugees. I mean, when you have 1.5 million refugees in Lebanon, a country of 4.5 million, what kind of situation do you have? In Jordan, it's the same thing, and even in Turkey, it's a huge problem. Now, ISIS has taken the problem militarily into Iraq. In Iraq, the media everywhere has been saying, presenting things as if a column of Toyotas came from Syria and took over overnight a city of 2 million people with a lot of military people there. That's not what has happened. ISIS started in Iraq, not in Syria. It went into Iraq, into Syria from Iraq, and it returned there. And my guess is that column of Toyotas came in when their people inside Mosul told them the situation is ready, come in, we're going to take over tomorrow. This is what has happened. Now, to start bombing ISIS is very good. ISIS will be defeated. Definitely, it will be defeated. It's not going to govern any part of Syria or Iraq at the end of the day. But it is very, very strange to see that, apparently from what I see from where I am sitting, the Americans and a lot of other countries are trying to destroy ISIS in Iraq, but they don't want to talk to Iran. Iran has more influence in Iraq than the United States or anybody else. So instead of telling them, part of what is happening, what led to ISIS is your behavior in Iraq. So come and sit down and let's see how we are going to work together to get rid of ISIS and then make sure that it doesn't, another ISIS doesn't come because of your behavior. No, we tell them, stay away. We will finish the job for you and then you continue exercising your influence in Iraq. That is something So the thing is, Iran has more influence than the United States in Iraq and more influence in Syria than Russia. And you say we don't talk to them and we want to deal with these problems. That's very, very strange. And I think, the earlier it changes, the better for everyone.
Michael, let me bring you in here. I've got one or two other questions I could definitely ask, but why don't you, and especially as you've participated throughout the session here and obviously leading this project. You come in with a couple of points.
I have to be very careful on the question of Iran, because when I was in the Foreign Office, I accompanied Jack Straw on many visits to Tehran. And of course, we met with President Rouhani and many of the others and wanted to open a political dialogue then with them about not just the nuclear question, but about Iraq. But I remember once when he famously asked Colin Powell if there were much support for this idea in the States. The Secretary of State answered, there's three of us. Myself, my assistant, and my wife, Ada. I'm not sure if that's in his memoir or not now. I wanted to go back to the first session when Hassan was talking about the feeling in much of Iraq and Syria that the Sunni were on the back foot. He even talked about political emasculation, and that this was something that ISIS has capitalized on in relation to the Shia and relation to Iran also. And we've talked in the past about Lebanon, and of course the most powerful narrative in Lebanon is that of Hezbollah, which is the only Arab force really in modern times, the last 20 years or so, to have taken on Israel. And Sunnis and other communities like the Maronites feel either in fear of Hezbollah or in deference to it. But is Hassan right about this, that ISIS is successfully capitalizing on that feeling of underachievement and of neglect by Sunni Muslims, particularly in Iraq?
Yeah, I mean, let's speak about Iraq, because the situation is different from one country to the other.
Correct.
In Iraq, the Americans invaded the country, got rid of Saddam, to the big satisfaction of Iran, and actually handed over the country to the most pro-Iranian Shia.
Correct.
The many of the new leaders in Iraq, in part, I think that now everybody is saying that, people like Maliki, mm-hmm. came animated by a spirit of revenge. Mm. And I think, I think they have written, some of them have written, actually. We are the majority. We represent double our population. The Shia are double the number of the Sunnis. Mm. They govern for 70 years. Mm. Since we are double of that they are, we'll govern for 140 years. many aspects of this, the Americans, wittingly or unwittingly, handing over the country to the most extreme Shia. Mm-hmm. Tariq Aziz, mm-hmm. I think the name is familiar, maybe mm-hmm. you've forgotten it. Tariq Aziz has been surrendered to the Americans. Americans declared war on Iraq. They won the war. He is one of the leaders. He went and he didn't hide like Saddam. Mm-hmm. He went over and surrendered to the victor. I think that law is that the Americans, the victors, would have tried him if they have anything, or released him. They handed him over to the Iraqi, the new administration they put together. They sentenced him to death. I and many others have asked the leaders of the new leaders of Iraq not to execute him, and they promised us that they will not. But I have been saying that he should be released. He has been there 12 years. Mm-hmm. He's over 80. Mm-hmm. Let him go and die with his family. Mm-hmm. I think I think Tariq Aziz is not known to have killed anybody. No. He is not known to have stolen any money from anywhere. So after 13 years of very, very hard conditions, he's detained under very, very hard conditions. Why don't they let him in? Go. Mm. And also, there are quite a lot of people like him who have done nothing under Saddam, They were, you know, they were living in that republic of fear just like everybody else. And many of them are in jail. And of course, much, much more have been sacked from their positions, have been dispossessed, and so on. So I think if you are fighting Daesh, Daesh is the result of this behavior of the Americans and of their Shia friends in Iraq. This has to change if we want to avoid the continuation of what is happening.
I mean, curiously, it seems to me the Americans should have taken an example from their own history in 1945 when they were the victorious allies marching into Germany. They were confronted by the Soviet Union, knew nothing about it, and immediately co-opted General Gehlen, Unternehmen Gehlen, into the CIA, which at that time had no fund of knowledge about the Soviet Union.
And they tried the people whom they thought, and they were you know, at the end of the day, very, very few. Not everybody who was in living in Germany under Hitler.
Your moment?
Lakhtar, in your years of experience in the UN and in national service, I mean, it strikes me over the past two decades, you, with great bravery in some ways, have worked successively in Afghanistan, Iraq, and Syria. How would you put the present context and the seriousness of the situation in some sort of comparative perspective when you look at your career?
The last mission is always the most difficult, isn't it? I have known Syria for a very, very long time, and liked the country and its people. And one of the things that was admirable in Syria, more than anywhere else, was that in Syria we didn't ask whether somebody was Muslim or Christian. I have friends whom I discovered that they were Christians after 20 years of dealing with them. So to see Syria destroyed the way it is extremely painful, very, very painful. It's a very, very serious problem. As you know, from day one I have been warning that, look, if you don't solve the problem in Syria, it will spill over all over the place. It has started with Iraq, but Jordan is under threat. Lebanon is, I mean, all credit to the Lebanese, that they are bearing 1.5 million refugees. And there is no, a civil war hasn't started again. That's all credit to all the Lebanese, that they are, you know, keeping themselves just on the verge of catastrophe. It's a very, very big problem. We need that peace plan I was talking about, and that peace plan will need the participation of Syrians, of course, but also of their neighbors. I think somebody said in the prison president the other two sessions, how neighbors have different agendas, where Syria is at best number two in their agenda. That has to change. We've got to address the Syrian issue. And remember, the Secretary General was the only one who kept saying, and he has been really insulted by a lot of people, say, don't give more weapons to Syria. Stop giving weapons to Syria. And have a peace plan, not a war plan. So I think that what you need, ultimately, people are starting now to say there is no military solution. But they are all working for military solutions. So they have got to really put their acts become a reflection of what they are saying. So get the neighbors together with the Syrians. I asked some friends who are very strong supporters of Bashar. After all that has happened, do you think that we are going back to the Syria that existed before March 2011? They thought, and I said, probably not. I don't think we can go back to what happened. And for that, you need Russia and you need Iran. A lot of people thought that they were going to defeat Bashar, and that he was going. Al Jazeera, as a matter of fact, at one stage said that there was a plane going to take him in the next few hours. That was silly and wrong. So I think he has to be part of the discussion and of the change that is needed. What I have been speaking about, the new Syria, a new Syria has to be built. And it will not be a divided Syria. Again, to say too many things in very short time. I think that Sykes-Picot is more resilient than people think. I don't think that the Iraq is going to disappear. I don't think that Syria is going to disappear. Of course, if we keep doing what we are doing, ultimately we will succeed in destroying both countries.
I now want to open it up to see if there's some comments and questions here from our participants. Just one last question on your point there about neighbors only having war plans. The Turkish leadership is trying to resist, it appears, playing a war role right now, and yet we're encouraging it to get involved militarily.
Sure.
Where would you sit on the advice you'd be giving to President Erdogan right now?
I'm sure he will not ask my advice. I think what has been the case is that everybody was, including many of the Syrians who are against Bashar, they were waiting for the cavalry to come the way it did in Libya. And they, I'm not sure, I think that they have, I'm not sure whether they have given up. They gave up in August 2013 when the Americans said they were going to bomb and then didn't. But I'm not sure whether this illusion or hope is not reborn again. So Erdogan doesn't want to send his troops now, but I'm not sure that he has given up the idea of a military victory over Bashar. I'm not sure that he has given that up.
Well, look, let me open it up. I'm sure there'll be lots of points and questions, and please make sure you introduce yourselves first. Gentlemen here, I'm just going at the speed I saw the hands. With the red top. The microphone's coming the other side, Seb, the other way.
My name is Farokh Negahdar from Iran. Two questions to Mr. Brahimi. First, in 2011 and 12, Mrs. Hillary trying to create a coalition against Bashar Assad to overthrow him. And the players of this coalition were the same as Mr. Kerry coalition to defeat Daesh. Do you think this is a continuity of a policy or a shift in policy? This is the first question. The second is about yourself. You resigned from Syrian commissioner of peace. You were a commissioner of peace. The reason of your resignation was the lack of peace plan, or the lack of possibility of to create a peace plan. Thank you.
Yeah, I don't see the difference between the two things in the second question, but definitely. You see, the United Nations has no clout. You know, we have no money, we have no troops, no weapons. the clout we use is borrowed from others. Our members, the members of the United Nations, they are duty-bound to give those that clout to their organization to do the job. When they don't, then you are helpless. And that clout was not made available to the United Nations. Mm. I wanted to leave one year earlier, exactly 1 year earlier. But on the 7th of May, 2013, Kerry and Lavrov got together and said some very, very important things. Syria is a very dangerous thing. Two, there is no military solution. Three, a political solution is possible. Four, we, Russia and America, are willing to work together and with others. So I tried to work on the basis of that, but it didn't get us anywhere. On your first question, whether it's a change or not, what has not changed, I think that Kerry and Lavrov really tried to come to an understanding. But they were coming from two very, very different, they were very, very far. They couldn't bridge the gap that separated them. I don't know what Ukraine has done to that possibility, but that is definitely something that is rather good. That was rather good on the international scene.
Okay, please in the front row first here.
I want to just respond to Mr. Brahimi's point. Actually, we're in agreement. I mean, there is no one has a peace plan. But I was trying to say that even if there is a peace plan on the top table, it's not going to translate into peace on the ground. You do need that bottom-up approach, the internal momentum to translate it into peace. The local driver are increasingly important, even among the regime. I mean, in Homs, for example, last week, the Damascus wanted the deal, very much wanted the deal, but the security forces in Homs were against it. So we have to take that local element into on board, and actually in our recommendations in the report, that's exactly what we say, that these localities have to be part of a central plan. However, Homs deal, which you cited, it was not a peace deal. And you knew, I mean, it was not, there was no peace element, even the Homs example. I mean, there was no two parties agreeing to end the fight. It was just demobilization of fighters, simply. And I was against it. It was not, whereas Berzey was a more of a win-win solution, and I think is a better example of a peace deal.
I agree with you 100%.
Okay. Let me keep moving around in that case. Gentleman right here first. And I'm going in the speed in which I saw the hands. I've got you, sir. Yeah. Go ahead.
Thank you. Yeah, my name is Leo from Business Monitor International. The question a Business Monitor International research house here in London. My question is there any possibility that the US-led coalition against the Islamic State will turn and target Assad, perhaps after the Islamic State, and if the Islamic State advance is limited? Thank you very much.
Some people are saying that, but if they want to destroy Daesh first, it will take them a hell of a long time.
So, yeah, there's not a sequence. And to be fair, I've got to go right to the back of the room, very, 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 very back. Yep, and I'm going to come here, exactly, yep. Right at the back, the gentleman standing up. Hope, I can see him looking at his paper. I hope this will be a short question.
We'll be sure, definitely. My question is, how do you see that Turkey ally with ISIS and supporting ISIS against its own people and abandoning the Kurds? There are 20 to 30 million Kurds in Turkey. Despite the Ban Ki-moon urge Turkey to open the border to the citizen of Kobane to defend their city, but Turkey not allowing our people dying, the Kurds are dying now, Turkey closing the border, the wounded even, they won't allow them to go to the hospital, Kurds crying because they want to go to defend their city, they're not allowing, ISIS tanks moving across the border, Turkish army, they can see them clearly, they ask the PYG to leave the gate because they want ISIS tanks to take over. What the United Nations, Arab League, your opinion on this? Why the Arabs, until now, they silence toward the Kurds? Aren't the Kurds are Syrian as well?
Thank you.
What support we have from the Arabs?
Okay.
Thank you.
I know Salah Muslim, and a lot of his friends. Salah Muslim is the leader of PYD. It's a tragic situation there. I don't represent either the Arab League or the United Nations. I just repeat, like some old broken, we need a peace plan for Syria. Not for the Kurds only, but certainly not without the Kurds. So that's all I can say.
Okay, first here, please.
William Patey, Control Risks, former diplomat, former ambassador to Iraq. Can I press you, Mr. Rahimi, on the peace plan and how we get there? Because you negotiated with Assad, you saw the Assad regime, you were very clear that Assad thinks he can win and the regime think they can win. And I know everyone's got a war plan. I know that one of the logical reasons for supporting the Syrian opposition is to knock Assad off his perch. And I presume in any peace plan, we're not going to want to have ISIS at the table, but they'll be there as a presence. What do you need things to happen to get a Geneva III or a peace plan? What is it we should be doing with Russia, with Iran, to get a peace plan? I think if a peace plan emerged, there'd be a lot of people quite desperate to grasp it because the war plans are not working.
Thank you very much. If I knew the answer to all your questions, then the problem would have been solved.
But
what I have been saying is that you have three concentric circles. First, the inner circle is the Syrians. Unfortunately, the Syrians were not in a position to talk to one another. Ideally, in a situation like this, it is the people who are fighting who should get together and solve their problem. They were not willing again, because it's not only Bashar who thought he was winning. His enemies also thought they were absolutely certain they were winning. And therefore, when we say, we want the negotiation, they say, you are supporting Bashar. The man is on the way out. We are going to kick him out. And you want us to negotiate with him. This was the position of the opposition in the beginning. So this inner circle alone cannot function. The neighbors, I think you've been talking about this all afternoon. And I think you've said that they have different agendas. This is also something I told the Americans, the Russians, and a lot of other people in the region. The first week I started it, you don't agree with one another. So how are you going to support these poor people in Syria? So please do something. So they created the London 11 and I don't know what. They haven't made that much progress. The outer circle, I thought, were the Americans and the Russians. Because again, the first meeting I had with all the players was in New York in September 2012. The two ministers who were really preoccupied about Syria knew quite a lot about it and understood that it has to be managed somehow, were Lavrov and Hillary Clinton. And that's what I have tried. I have criticized it, and he wants to talk only to the Americans and the Russians, and he is working with the Americans, if not for the Americans. But it is true that I haven't succeeded. Now, speaking from outside, the Russians, the Americans, and the countries in the region have got to come together and face one another and talk and criticize one another, complain from one another, but at the end of the day, try to put something together with the Syrians to end the war and build the new Syria. The new Syria has, we have got to learn from Iraq. We cannot disband the Syrian army. We must not disband the... We must also keep the bureaucracy. It is needed, and it will cooperate with whatever new system. And, again, Is it possible that only the vice president of Syria has, you know, doubts about the policy in the country amongst the, is that possible? Only Farouk Shara has some objections to what Bashar is doing? I'm sure it's not the case, and that in the army, in the bureaucracy, in the security apparatus, much feared for very good reasons. I'm sure that there are a lot of people, I think that's what Rima was saying, there are a lot of people who will participate in building, in starting the road to the building of the new Syria.
And Iran has to be part of that.
Absolutely.
Just to go back to what you said earlier.
Absolutely.
Without Iran, it won't work.
No, look, I mean, Iran has more influence in Syria than Russia. I'm sure Lavrov won't mind me quoting him on this. Lavrov said, we have less influence in Damascus than America has in Tel Aviv. So, I'm sure he's exaggerating.
which one did he exaggerate? Yeah. Okay, I've got a lot of people asking questions. We said we'd break at 5:15. We started late. Why don't I just give a chance for three or four people to say something? Sure. You can choose whether you want to say something back, but sure, please keep it short. So we're bang on. First gentleman here, there, with your hand up. Keep your hand up, sir. Yeah, just keep your hand up. Microphone's coming. Wait. There you go.
I'm desperate for an analogy. And being slightly older than the earlier panels, is there any relationship, do you think, between what ISIS is doing for the Sunni population in giving them pride and so on, as to what the National Socialists did in Germany in the 30s?
Interesting. So the ISIS is a giver of encouragement to Sunnis. Lady here, yep. Microphone coming in the corner. Sorry, and I'm going to go to people who I don't always give a chance to ask questions, so I apologize for
Nazarene
people who know me well.
Sorry, Chatham House member and Kehan London. What is the effect of the impact of the resolution of the nuclear question with
the
Iran?
The resolution
of the nuclear question with Iran, U.S. West resolution, right, on the Syria.
Good point. And lady there, microphone's coming.
Gabrielle Rifkin, Oxford Research Group. Lekhtar, you've been very clear, and so have many people in the room, that there's a proxy war primarily going on. And key to that are the Iranians and the Saudis. When you were in the role of special envoy, how much attempts were there to bring the Iranians together on the Sunni-Shiite regional hegemony question? How far were the quiet talks going on behind the scenes? And if not then, or what happened then, and what's in people's minds in terms of a peace plan, not a war plan, now on that?
The Iran Saudi. I think we better stop there. I know I'm disappointing a lot of people. My apologies to people who had their hand up early, but we're not going to have time, and we're already well over. How about, do you want to take some of those on?
Well, yeah, you know, one sentence. I don't think that Sunnis see Daesh as a source of pride, not even in Iraq or Syria. You know, the Al-Qaeda came into Iraq, did not exist in Iraq, came into Iraq because of the invasion. But then, you know, the Sunnis, when they were promised that things will improve, they have defeated Al-Qaeda. It's not the surge. It is the Sunnis in, you know, those tribes that have defeated and destroyed Al-Qaeda. So I think that in Mosul, I'm not sure that a lot of people supported Daesh. They let them do what they did. And I think if they are told again that your conditions will improve, they will rise against Daesh. But this time, I think they will be, you know, they will want a little bit better commitment than last time around. The nuclear thing, yeah, sure. I mean, definitely, if a deal is is reached, that in itself is very much welcome. And maybe it will facilitate a little bit the give and take between Iran and others.
And if it does, does it matter? Because that's maybe a likely outcome.
Not very much. No, I think this is a very, very big problem. It is not born out of the nuclear problem. It's a very, very big problem where Iran has influence. That influence has to be recognized. And as a matter of fact, a lot of, I'm not saying that Iran should be, should be given a reward because they have influence. On the contrary, I think what I'm saying is that Iran has got to act responsibly and not continue to fan the war and the injustice that it imposed on a lot of people. Yeah, whether all this makes sense or not, I don't know. Thank you very much indeed.
Okay, the Saudi thing, but we'll leave that for later. Look, we've gone time over. I want to just a quick word of thanks to Lakhdar Brahimi, but also Michael, thank you for being up here and sharing your thoughts. If you could stay in your seats for a minute, because we're going to get some comments from Doris. But first, please, a hand for Lakhdar Brahimi.